Good evening, my beautiful crime family, and happy Easter to all of you. I hope you all had an awesome one. I wonder what you all ate. If, was it ham, or was it turkey, or was it something else? I was home. Yep, the man of many hats. I do, too. I really got a lot. I mean, right here, I'm counting at least 20. I'm sure of it. I'm home alone this Easter, so I chefed up, which I don't do often, being all old and living alone and everything, you know what I mean? And most of the time I throw a pot pie or two in the oven. But today I had cowgirl in the sun, nummy. that's like, yeah, that's good shit there. Yeah, well, let's read some of this. Well, Teacher just likes pineapple cake. Leah had grilled chicken and pineapple cake for moonflower and prime rib by Cowgirl. Ooh, nummy. Chicken salad, potato rice for Joey. And good to see you, Joey. Pasta, Michelle, ham by Ro. Hash and rice by Hope Floats. Yes. I had Szechuan beef. I chefed up myself. And yeah, it's one of my favorite dishes. I'll show you a picture. I do got a picture of it on the computer. I put a little bit too much on my plate. It's like, I only ate like half of it. I can't eat like that anymore. I mean, I'm still plating up like when I was young, and I don't eat like that, man. It's like, what the hell? You know? I don't even know if it was quite half, to tell you the truth. Oh, we're going to have some fun tonight, though. But I want to say hi to my crime family. Welcome to Once Upon a Crime Time. And I'm your host, Tommy Jude. And hello, Joey. And good to see you. And Michelle, good to see you. And Moonflower Laza, my girl, good to see you. And Ruth, good to see you. And Kiki, good to see you. Ooh, chicken and dumplings with mashed potatoes, corn, coconut, cream pie. Never had that one before. Which that is good. Rondi, good to see you. Ash Cash, good to see you, girl. And of course, Kathy, my girl. Cold or covered, good to see you. And Sooner Girl, good to see you. Eddie Van Halen's guitar pick, I know who you are. Hey, that was a good, I really enjoyed being on panel with you that night, Eddie's guitar pick. I really did. That was a good one. And T-Touch, keep going up. Jackie Bushelo, good to see you. Ro, good to see you. Lila, good to see you. Debbie Gazzardo, always good to see you. And yeah. It's been busy with a few lives out there, so I don't know how it's going to go, but I just wanted to come on. And there's my true killer crap. There was a link there for you, girl. I don't know if you've seen it or not, but I'll put it there again. And there we are. And now where am I? Okay, I'm over here. And good to see you, Sherry. And Vicky, good to see you. And okay, I think that's it for now. Yeah. Lisa, good to see you. Eve, good to see you. Wendy, good to see you. Okay. What a sweetheart to do that. Thank you very much. Randy, good to see you, brother. All right. So we're going to be going over a few things tonight. We're gonna kind of go back. Oh, Sherlock, good to see you. We're going to be going back over that. I don't know if it bothers you as much as if it bothers you like it bothers me. That video of two killers. Because, I mean, when we did I knew what I seen, you know. But until somebody really verifies it and other people start seeing it, you question yourself. You know what I mean? It's like, and now that other people are seeing it and they're doing things to bring it more into light, and you're starting to see this stuff, and even better, it's like, what the hell? You know what I mean? And then I heard, so we're going to get into that, but we're going to get into a lot. There's other stuff to get into here. And then I do get thoughts once in a while. Most people think they're crazy thoughts, but you know, but I seen somebody I really, respected and respect. I still respect, and admire, but they said that they weren't going to get into it because it's just out there. And that kind of bothers me a little bit because until somebody can look at me and say, it isn't true. It isn't, you know, they doctored it. They, you know, until somebody can do that, I can't let go of this. As a matter of fact, I'm getting stronger about it. And I'm getting stronger about what Billy's seeing. Even though I wasn't seeing everything that she was seeing. But now looking at this stuff, I'm starting to see what she was seeing. And, you know, I even called her crazy. You know what I mean? And, especially when it came to the orange monkey. she kept saying it, you know, and I couldn't see it, but whatever. So anyway, and then we have a special guest. Where is she? Cat Chaos. Cat Chaos. Yeah, I know what that's like. You know? Hey, Robert, how you doing, brother? Oh, and we got Kathleen is drooling. Oh, I love my crying family. And Joey likes white chocolate pretzels. I got him talking on food now, man. They're all going to be going for seconds and thirds here pretty soon. Oh, boy. Okay, let me leave. I'll put that that link out there again. There we go. All right, link is out there, True Killer. I messed up. I forgot this when we were talking, emailing back and forth. I forgot to send you the link. Oh, nice, Robert. Nice, nice. You catching anything? Oh, cheesecake. That's like, Joey, that's like one of my weaknesses. Really, it really is. Okay. You catching anything, Robert? And then I want to introduce our guest for tonight, and everybody loves her, Miss Killer. How you doing, girl?
Happy Easter. I'm doing good. Girl. How are you?
I'm all right. How was... What's that, girl?
No Easter hunting?
No what?
Easter egg hunting? Oh, hold on. I think I have my TV on in the background. Was that interrupted? Can you hear me good?
I can hear you good. No, I don't hear any TV or nothing. Just make sure you shut off your otherwise you're going to be doubling up. Shut off your YouTube.
Okay, you just watch it. I had it on, sorry. Is that better? Yeah.
It should be better for you. Yeah. Joey, I know what you're talking about. And today is my son's birthday, the one that was, that's gone. And that was one of his favorites, Joey. We called it fruit pizza. I think that's what you're referring to. Yeah, he loved that fruit pizza. So how was your Easter, Miss Killa?
It's good. It's still going on.
It's still going on, right. Right.
But it's good. I have my nephews and nieces over. I don't really get nice. To see them that much, even though they live like 5 minutes.
Right, yeah. I live about 3 hours or something, so.
I got a cutting board.
What's that? Something about a cutting board? You were just starting to cut out. Oh. Miss Killa? You there? Oh. We don't hear it. Did you mute yourself, Killa? Did you accidentally mute yourself or something? Miss Killa? Hello? We don't hear you. So you might be muted. Look down below on the left. Down below. Behind my right below my picture. White ounce bluegill, Robert. Okay. Killa, we don't hear you, girl. Where are you? Oh, she dropped out. Okay, she'll be back. Let me go look again, and then we're gonna start running some stuff here because I'm going to leave this for my mods. This is let Killa know that it's there. She can jump back up. And okay, so anyway, things I want to talk about a little bit. We don't really have to watch the video, I don't think. We've watched it now, quite a few times. But True Killa was saying that if you do what she did, and I'm going to explain to you what she did and how she got it so you can actually see what's going on in those reflections. And that's the best job I've ever seen. She took her 50-inch TV, but what I didn't understand was if it was her phone or an iPad, but anyways, she took it and she recorded it close up. She couldn't see anything. She just recorded the back of that. And I can show, you know what? I'll show you. I got to show you it here for a second, quick second here. So you understand what I'm talking about. Because I want everybody, if you want to, you can do this on your own. And, I don't have it up. Okay, great. Anyway, you take that vehicle in the front, and you record it with your. Let's say you're using a phone. That's what it looked like she used, was her phone, and you take your 50-inch TV and you zoom in, but not like. Super, super close, but you zoom in to try to get it closer than you would with just doing it online. You see what I'm saying? You have a little more control now. So you're taking your 50-inch screen and you're going in on it, and then you're blowing it up and then record. You're not going to see anything until you start watching it again. And then watch it on TV again. She said that she thinks it can be done one more, you know, another time or two to make it even clearer. So if you want to try it, take that vehicle in the front and the back, like by the back tail light and around that area, and even on the side panel a little bit, and you just record it. It's kind of zoomed in. You might not see anything, but just keep recording. Keep recording. And then when it's over, then look at it. And then put it back on. Take it and put it on your TV from your phone. You can use your Xbox or your computer or whatever. And that's how she did it. So that's one way of doing it. And it's the clearest I've ever seen it. Maybe we should run it for just a little bit here. I thought I could have swore I had Bubblies up here or somebody or two kilos up here. What is this? Oh, that's me. Okay. Let me go here. I think it's good that people will understand this, because then they can try it themselves and see what they come up with. Because I mean, that was pretty mind blowing. It really was. It just, okay, just give me a second here. Okay. Well, I can use this. I'm just going to use this one. We're not going to listen to it or anything. I'm just going to show you what I'm talking about. Okay. I'm just going to show you. Okay. And present. Geez, I wonder what happened to Killa. All right. And I mean, we've seen this enough times, and I'm not going to keep going over it. But if you, I mean, you really, if you haven't seen it, go to Bubbly Waters and look at what she's got. And but if you want the source of it, then go to True Killer Crime and look at those videos, because that is the clearest I have seen it. So in here, see, like all in here, right there, all in there. And even down in here, you know what I'm saying? But if you take your phone and you play this on your 50-inch TV and you record it close up, and just keep recording, even if you're not seeing anything, because you're not going to see anything. Then take it and download it on your computer and put it on your TV screen and then watch it. And then you will see what is going on. And that's how she did it. That's how she got it so good. Oh, there you are. the kitties again, huh? Okay, let me send you the link. I'm gonna let her explain it, okay? Because she can explain it better than me. There you go, girl. Okay, we're back.
Okay, sorry about now? That. My apologies.
All good?
Yeah, everything's good.
Yeah, that's fine. Okay. Now, I was trying to explain to them how you got it so good.
Yes.
And you said it could probably be done again, maybe a time or two. Okay,
I think everybody can do it. Just play it off of your TV. If you have like a 50-inch, like a big screen TV, more play it right. YouTube, watch YouTube from the TV and watch that footage, and then put your phone or tablet right on that area, and then
so you use the tablet, not your phone.
I used my phone the first time, and when I did, like, where you see, like, it looks like two heads there, like, you can literally see the eyeball moving around with my
phone. Are you serious?
Yeah, that's, like, how close it was blowing up. Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, hey, Eddie Van Halen's guitar pick, you hear that? Take your phone. You want to see eyeballs and stuff?
Yeah. Is that Jeff?
I do believe that is him, yes. Mm-hmm. Okay. Eddie's guitar pick there. Do that and see what you come up with. Anyway, yeah, I thought I just, you know, it kind of blows me away. And I do have some thoughts for tonight. Before we get into, I think I might share Bubbly's story.
Yes. Love Bubbly. That, is she here?
That, I know. And no, and now I haven't seen her. I gotta call her when we're done here, probably. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because I kind of know what's, yeah. Do you talk to her on the phone or anything?
No, just,
okay.
I just been watching her videos she's been posting. I guess the time being that she was away, she's catching up and she had a lot of work that she wanted to like share.
Right. Yeah. But I do got some ideas about this. Now, here's one thing I want people to remember is the night before there was 150 people at a party at that house. And people questioned me, well, you know, how can there be so many people over at Linda Lane? There was 150 people at the house the night before. Know what I mean?
It's very strange that, you know, the noise complaint videos with the body cams, like there's parties, noise going on all the time there. And then one night during a big game.
Right. I know. Right. And it's all these little things that add up to, you know, something rotten went down.
And then when you see Dylan, you see Bethany appearing on those body cams, but they're not coming to the door, you know, and they live there also. It just looks all like suspicious, just that alone the way it looks.
Yep, I agree. And that's a big thing there too, is it was one of the biggest nights of the year. Actually, they had two football games going on. They tried to make it sound like it was like all slow and everything. And you know, that was not the case.
Do they have that game every year?
Both WSU and Idaho were both had games.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I mean, it was a you know, definitely a busy night. You know what I'm saying? And then it was parents' night or something like that, wasn't it? Somebody, what was it? There was some kind of other special night, wasn't it? Parents' night or something.
That's probably why they're all in their best behavior.
Right, Simon. Win or lose, vandals always booze. Maybe Dylan's boyfriend was maybe homecoming. Was it homecoming? It was something like that. Yeah, or parents' night. Or
there was homecoming a couple days before that, I believe. That's why Kaylee was invited back by Dylan as her number one, or I think tough one.
Well, then it would have been the night of the football game. Then it was homecoming. Know what I mean?
We had a lot going on that night.
Right. Yeah, busy night. So anyway, I was thinking about that. You know, people are always questioning me about, about so many people. It takes so many people. And I was like, yeah, there was that many people there. I mean, if 150 can show up at that house, 150 can definitely show up at Linda Lane. And then. You know, people are going, 400 people? How's, you know, what is she talking about, 400 people? And, well, if there's 150 at Linda Lane. And it makes me think of a lot. I like going through the comments after and stuff, too, you know. And I read some interesting comments, but I lost what I was just going to say, so I'll keep going. What else here? Yeah, and here's another thing too. Here's another thing is the cleanup job. The cleanup wasn't just the house. You know what I mean? It was the whole neighborhood. That, and the people ask why, you know, why the 8-hour delay? Well, if you're cleaning, have to clean up a whole neighborhood. I mean, you're talking like Linda Lane and the house. And the, I mean, there was a, that was a, that's a huge cleanup job.
Yeah, I remember you were saying something about seeing pressure washers on the reflection.
We heard them. We heard them. Yeah.
Washers, drones flying around, generators. Right.
Yep. We heard that stuff. And it is in there.
But you don't see nothing. But when you really like look and just take your time to like look, like what we know what you did does. And right. He explains how to do it. He does it right in front of you. So, you know, just try that alone and see for yourself.
Right. And I have Akilah's, her link is down in the description. Okay. And I'm sure the mods are posting it, but I also have a couple others in there that I just thought, we know what you did is also posted down in the description. I was thinking of running hit one of his vids too, but if I'm going to run that story, that's an hour long. You know what I'm saying?
that was some really like crazy stuff, like what he did with the grub truck.
I know.
You can literally see like what was there in the grub truck. Like, how did he do that? He did it with like the still shots or the frames, whatever he does there. He like slows it down
right.
And then he goes back. And when you do that, you do like see for a quick second things will appear. Right, and it just looks right. Like so strange, like the stuff that does appear, it's almost like it's all like witch, like I don't know how to explain it, like witchcraft, demonic, just creepy stuff.
Something was creepy was going on. I talked to him a little bit today, or her. I don't know if it's a him or a her. Do you know?
I have no idea.
Neither do I. And
I wish I could like talk to you. We know what we did.
And you know me, and well, I'm always saying, well, I don't know, girl, or you know what I mean, and I don't know what to say to. I'm like stuck.
Just call them. Hey, we.
But I did talk to them today, just through messaging back and forth, yeah, on the comments, and. He's like, it's going to come, and I agree with him. It's going to come to a point where they can't ignore this stuff. You know what I mean? It's going to come to that point.
Crazy, but it's literally there. You're seeing it. I see it. Others are seeing it.
Right. And I think it's going to come to that point. Mm-hmm. And I think it's going to come to a point. Now, there's five of us, right?
Yeah.
As far as I know, there's five. There might be more that I don't know about. But who is it? There's you and I and Bubbly, and we know what you did. And Rolo, right. Yeah. So there's five of us. By the time this is done, they're going to be wishing that they that they had looked into it a little bit further.
I think we just got to, like, teach people how to do it, and they should try it on their own and see what they're, like, Jeff was saying. Jeff, you were saying that you wanted to try it and look into it. You know,
he did. Yes, he did. And we had a nice talk about it in Robert's whatever his channel.
Is he gonna show like what he did?
I'd like to know. If he sees it, he's probably gonna go hide it.
Maybe this is enhancement. He enhanced it too much, probably.
Right. Now I don't see him talking. Did he leave already? Oh, no,
I
he's there.
I actually don't have Jeff legs. I can't see him.
Eddie.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, he keeps asking me for this timestamp. I'll have to get a hold of Karen on that.
Right there. He doesn't take the time to even check. Like, look at it. I put the timestamps right on the video. I'll share that. It's right. I'll show the timestamp.
But he's looking for the victory sign. Do you know where that timestamp is?
No, I haven't.
It's got. I think it's between 2:20 and 2:30.
I think it's actually four 4:40. Maybe or 3:40.
With the victory? With the victory thing?
Yeah, if you listen, you can hear kind of they're chanting like after three. I believe it's 3:40. They start chanting like, whoa, you know? You can hear like chanting like celebrating. Huh.
Okay. See, I couldn't see when Karen was showing me, and you have to be just right with it. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. To get there, just to get to that spot.
Yeah, and, it takes a lot of time. It takes a lot of time. Like,
and I think that's what Jeff. Maybe you don't.
You really have to have patience to do
it. You got to have patience. A lot of patience.
And it's a lot of data, like. Just to upload a video or save a video, you have to go through your storage and like I'm paying like $2 right now a month just for storage, just so I can do this, and it's still not enough.
Well, and all the stuff that we used to get thrown at us, you know, but you know, blah blah blah. It's like you don't know how hard it is to get there.
I'm not trying not to like focus on all that. I just want to put the videos out and show it and. I don't look at the comments or nothing like that.
Right. All right. And what was I looking at? Oh, and here's
for you, Bubbly and Rolo, and we know what you did. I probably wouldn't have gotten into it.
Well, I'd like, and Kathleen is my agent pretty much. Mm-hmm. I would really like to get you, us five on panel.
Yeah, that would be awesome.
I think that would really be awesome. You know,
it would be really helpful too.
What's that?
It would be like helpful just to you know that.
Yeah, I think so. I think it would help people because we all did it separately, and I was doing it with Karen, but doing it separately at the same time because mm-hmm. of course we live miles apart. Yeah. But so we all have our own experience with it. Yeah, I think it would help. Because not every experience is okay. I'm going to get to that right now. What Joey was talking about and what Michelle is talking about. So here's something I had thought of. You remember when the video guy was out there and he said that you know he heard. Kaylee, hollering for Murphy at the house around 2:00. Do you remember that?
No.
The video guy. Okay, everybody, the video dude, and then
videos, crimes, videos, or something. He's a YouTube channel.
No, okay. There was a guy videoing the house that night.
I just actually heard that last night off of someone. They were mentioning that.
I've known it for a long time. Okay. They said there was a girl that ran from the house.
You can hear a girl at 2. I believe it's 2:14. If you really listen, you will hear someone running. And then you'll hear like girls just like, you know, they just seem like.
Right.
You really have to.
Well, here's my idea. They all said Bethany took off running, you know, and all that. No, not Bethany. Not Bethany. It was Maddie running from the house, and they caught her.
That's the only thing that
at the hydrant. They caught her at the hydrant.
Yeah, that's the only thing that would make sense is Maddie. I'm just saying like that's what makes sense. Why else would you hear that, and why else would that jacket be there? And you think like them investigating a crime scene, they would put everything into evidence, especially that jacket.
I can't even believe they just dropped it. Like, oh, it's a piece of garbage. What the
fuck? That's what got me so focused into this case is just the way how they investigated the crime scene, how they handled it. Like, I was just shocked. I'm like, I can't fucking, like, are they gonna get in trouble over this? Like, I was waiting. I'm like, you know, what's gonna happen?
Right. Right. Yeah. I mean, it's crazy. It's crazy.
For sure.
So there's a thought there. It's not Bethany running from the house. It's Maddie running from the house, and they caught her. And that's why that jacket is there. They caught her, but they didn't bring her back to the house. They brought her to Linda Lane.
Yeah. That just makes more sense to me. It all adds up. If you hear someone running on Linda Lane and there's a jacket that looks like Maddie's jacket there, and it happens at that time frame, who was around at that time frame? It all lines up with their statement, like the statement.
And that guy, he said, if I remember right, he said it was 2 o'clock. It was when they got home. And
yeah, and especially the first
yeah, report. Kaylee was out hollering for the dog. And she said that it was Ethan whistling. I don't think it was Ethan. I think it was because there was a truck, he said, parked in front of the house. And I'm pretty sure that was Jacob Hartz. That was there. It wasn't Ethan whistling for Murphy. And that would make more sense because it's Jacob Hart's dog.
Yeah.
Not Ethan's. You know what I'm saying? It doesn't make sense with Ethan whistling for Murphy.
Mm-hmm. It would only make sense for it to be him, for that dog barking.
Yeah, yeah. Makes way more sense. Okay, unless so.
Somebody else with the dog. Nobody has been really showing much on that, have they?
Okay, then we have, everything points, and I mean everything.
Points. I'm just Linda Lane. If you really pay attention to it and watch it, a lot there, a lot goes on, and it all adds up. Like, there's nothing else. Like, nothing else makes sense, especially all the speculating.
And that's what I was going to say. That everything, I mean everything, points to Linda Lane being the place where at least two were taken out. That's my opinion. And maybe all four. I don't know. I'd like to talk to you, maybe not tonight because it's Easter and you still got family there, but I'd like to do an offline with you sometime.
Yeah, no problem. You have my email.
Yeah, no, offline means you come into my stream yard here and it's like this, except it's just offline. But we can see each other, we can talk to each other and blah blah blah. Yeah.
That'd be cool. That'd help.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. Then, now here's another thing. People say, well, because of the people that were involved who got the film. Okay. And we know they don't have a very good name. We know that. Okay. But there's somebody out there, and I already know you know who it is. There's one person out there. There's one person out there that has the original film.
Virgin copies. The Virgin Linda Lane.
And you looked at that, and you seen the reflections.
I saw the reflections.
Yes, and that is my... Oh man, I didn't want to say his name because everybody knows that we battle.
I'm pretty sure he'll get the clue.
Yeah. Get a shoe. Get a shoe has copies that are the original, folks.
I believe
he's got them until noon. He's got them until noon. Nobody's got them until noon. Nobody.
Yeah, I believe he does have all those hours. He keeps coming out with every hour. I have 4 to 5. But before, I think it was just a couple weeks ago, he showed 6 to 7.
Right. And they're still fighting?
he showed the I believe it's a Dodge Charger driving by and it's light out. He just quickly talked about it, showed it, and I'm like, that's fucking 67. Oh, sorry. We're swearing, but yeah. Right.
Yeah, that's all right. I swear on here all the time. I've been trying to cut back though, because I think they've been shadow banning me a little bit for like months.
What's shadow banning?
They spank you, man. They take subs away from you and stuff.
Oh no.
Right. So anyway, so Get It Clue's got original film and and you looked at the four. No, you seen it at 5 o'clock or something too, right?
That's the recent one that I was working
now,
on.
See, that's what Karen and I were saying, is that they were still fighting at 5 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah, you do hear people like you be a guy crying and yelling,
right?
In the distance, if you really listen, you will hear them in the distance. You can hear like people, it sounds like guys crying actually, and like some yelling going on, like someone's angry.
Well, I'm sure there was some people pretty upset about what happened. You know what I mean?
That's what I figured.
Yeah, and then the 8 hours, I mean, they had to clean up a neighborhood, they had to clean up maybe a house.
Yeah.
But here's my idea too. We all heard about Kaylee being 54 times, right? I do believe that that at that time when that went down, there was probably 54 people there. You get my drift?
Yeah. I believe a lot of people were involved. A lot of people.
Right. And but see, the thing is, if they make everybody do one, they're mm-hmm. all involved.
That's what Bubbly was saying, and it makes sense.
Right. Oh, did she say that? Bubbly say that?
Yeah, she was talking about it. Yeah.
Not that little turd.
She was talking about it when she shared the reflection video. She was mentioning mm-hmm.
I got to give her a call. So, yeah, those are some of the thoughts that I had. And then
like, we wanted everybody to be involved so nobody would talk. So they had to be involved. If right. you didn't, if you weren't involved, you'd be off too.
Exactly. So. Yep. Okay, so we're going to look at something fun. I don't know if you guys have seen this or not, but there's a story that Bubbly Waters posted, and this is by a guy by the name of Dougie, I got him posted down below in my description. And this is a story that relates. Can relate. I want you everybody to listen to the story, but it's kind of a long one, but it's very, very, this guy is really a really good storyteller. But he's telling the truth. Because if you watch part two of this, which I'm not going to show tonight, but if you watch part two of this, he tells you, no, this is a true story of mine.
Yeah, and everything he explains in there about going to that party, it all makes sense and with what could have happened during that night.
Right. Yep. Now, I really want you guys to listen to this story because it is really, it's freaky. It is. It's really freaky. Okay, here we go. In a second. There we go. And this is, I'll tell you the guy. She's going to tell you the guy's name on here. There he is right here. Let me see what his name is here. Just got to back this up.
Yeah,
right there. Dougie Corrado. Okay. That's the guy's name. He's got a really good website. He's got like 200 and some thousand subscribers. So it's a really good channel. Here we go. Listen to the story.
It's as if you're in a word. Anyway, so I'm going to flip the phone back around and I'm going to start playing this. And if it'll do it for me, there we go. So I'm going to just play a little bit and we'll go from there.
You guys, welcome back to another story. If you really love spooky, scary stories told in the first person, you're on the right channel. I encourage you to like and subscribe if you want, right? It helps me. If it helps me, it helps you. The more it helps me, the more stories I can get to you. So subscribe button if you don't mind. This story I dropped a few months ago, and it didn't get any traction when I initially started dropping it. And then it started to blow up on Facebook a month in, but a lot of people demanded another part. So this is going to be the full story of the society with an extra part at the end. I'm so happy people started enjoying this. I really appreciate it. Enjoy the show. So this story is the reason I stopped making content for 5 years. You guys remember when all those Vine stars and skit Instagrammers moved to LA in like 2015-ish? So I wasn't a huge creator at the time, but I was going to LA 3 weeks after high school with like $2,000 in my pocket that I saved up working at Steak and Shake with this other aspiring creator named David. I was much more into editing and being behind the camera at that time, and he was much more into Vine and vlogs and being on camera. That time of our lives was absolutely crazy. Everybody was broke, posting anything we could onto YouTube to get some attention. I happened to get a spot at the now notorious 1600 Vine Apartments, and David got a spot a little bit closer to USC. Everyone was collaborating with everyone, and it was the era of clickbait YouTube. And to be honest, it was extremely fun for the first few months until Hollywood started to notice that influencers were the next big thing and that the landscape of the industry was changing. And we started to get invited to more exclusive. Old Hollywood was almost grooming new Hollywood. And there was rumors of this one gathering that was happening on a monthly basis where it seemed like anybody that got invited secured huge brand deals right after attending. But apparently this gathering worked on a buddy system. Someone had to vouch for you and bring you as a guest. And by blind luck, me and David ended up getting invited. Some talent agent saw me and David shoot a silly skit at a random party. He didn't invite us that second. He just told us that he saw something special in us and took our contact information. And listen, people do that all the time in LA, but this guy had a different feel to him. He didn't invite us that contact information. And listen, people do that all the time in LA, but this guy had a different feel to him. He wasn't trying to convince us he had connections or hype himself up like everybody else does. He was just super calm and had a sharp way of speaking that demanded respect. He was extremely brief, and after getting our numbers, he just said, "Look out for the invite," and walked away. And this is where it gets weird. I never gave this guy my address. I only gave him my number, but I ended up getting an invitation by letter. And at the time, I thought that that was so cool. But in retrospect, as an adult looking back at it, that alone was a huge violation of privacy and a major red flag. But at the time...
Okay, so I'm going to stop it right there. So... this is to all of those boys and girls out there who think that being is cool. Listen to what this guy says. He thought it was cool at the time. I'm just here to say that you might want to rethink this. You might really, really, truly want to listen to this video, what he's going to tell you, because it's definitely something that goes right along with the Greek system.
That was so cool. But in retrospect, as an adult looking back at it, that alone was a huge violation of privacy and a major red flag. But at the time, when I tell you, I was absolutely buzzing with excitement. When I got it, the letter was so extravagant and detailed. It was gold with black and red lettering that read something like, "Your talents have been noted, your name has been endorsed, and I'll never forget this part. The dreams you've been chasing are a night away through the seventh heaven." And the address was a beautiful home in Laurel Canyon that was set to happen that weekend. It also noted to not be a minute late and not to expect to leave before midnight. And at the time, it felt like the Willy Wonka golden ticket. And the excitement doubled when I got a text from David at the same time, in all caps saying, "Did you get one too?" I felt like our lives were about to change. And I was right. David blew up after this party, and I had to go into hiding. I felt like our lives were about to change. And I was right. David blew up after this party, and I had to go into hiding. When I tell you I was on cloud nine leading up to that party, I was so young and naive and delusionally optimistic. I truly believed that I was going to to this party and leave. I've never been a braggy person, but when you're young and excited, you get consumed by good news and want to talk to your friends and peers about it. So everybody that I chatted with who I knew was a content creator and was in the know about this party, I couldn't help but you try to get me into the next one. And even some from bigger creators saying, I'll see you there, with like a little smirk on their face. Like they were pumped for it. Except for one conversation with a creator that most of you probably know. This creator is an extremely positive guy. And he's one of the most wholesome, bubbly, genuine guys I met out there. And when I told him the good news, he looked at me like I told him a tsunami was headed towards the building. The usual joy that this man brought to every conversation turned into real fear and concern. And he made me leave the lobby and come up to his apartment before explaining anything to me. Like he was scared that somebody was going to overhear our conversation. When we got up to his apartment, he was just pacing. Like he had no idea how to start this conversation. But when he finally spoke up, all he said was, listen, Doug, I know you're excited, but I'm begging you, please do not go. That man is not who you think he is. He was being so frantic and I could see tears welling up in this guy's eyes. But I was young and I thought that I knew everything. I didn't even think the talent agent that sent us the invite was important. I was interested in the connections and I didn't really care if the talent agent was shady or if his intention was to sign me to a bad deal. I thought I'd just say no to any bad contract that he tried to send me, but still get to reap all the benefits of the party. So I tried to pry a little bit and ask follow-up questions, but all he gave me was, I have a friend who went and he hasn't been the same since he didn't cooperate. I don't know what he saw or what they did to him, but Doug, I do not want to see that happen to you. I start reassuring him that they won't make me do anything that I don't want to do. I don't even drink, let alone take any party favors. So peer pressure isn't much of an issue for me. I make up a lie to get out of the situation because, to be honest, I selfishly wanted to stay excited about this party and I really didn't want to hear anything negative about it. So I jokingly told him that I'd text him when I got home and that I had to leave to edit some videos tonight. What I was really doing was calling my dad to beg him for $100 to buy a rental suit. Mind you, we were all still poor and I was living in an apartment that I could barely afford. My dad reluctantly sent me the money and I immediately texted David to pick me up tomorrow at 5 p.m. so we could both get our suits before the party and grab food before we head to the party at 11. When David picked me up the next day, he was so excited and in such a great mood that I had to hide my concerns from him, at least while we were shopping for the rental suits. I had to manufacture excitement because David always has his camera out, and I wouldn't just be spoiling the mood, I would be ruining the content that he was trying to record. So I went along with it throughout the shopping process. Our plan was to drop his car off at my apartment, walk to the In-N-Out Burger on Sunset Boulevard, eat, and then change into our suits in the bathroom and hop into the Uber so we didn't smell like burgers. When we finally sat down to eat, I took that opportunity to bring up the warning that my friend gave me the day before in his apartment. I told him everything that he said to me and how scared he looked when he said it, and that I was feeling a little bit worried about going to this party. David cut me off before I even got to finish my sentence and firmly said we're going, and then went on a rant about how my friend is a jealous clout chaser and that he's just salty that his content isn't good enough and would never be invited to something like this. He said it in a half-serious, half-joking tone like he always does when he wants to get his way. Then he finished off by guilting me and saying, Doug, don't ruin this opportunity for us. Please just get through this party for me. I'd never heard anybody talk about my friend that way, but I'd known David for so much longer, so I trusted his judgment. So I nodded my head and called the Uber. We changed in the bathrooms and hopped into the Uber, and David starts recording again. So I have to pretend to be excited again. But once we got off the side streets and started driving up Laurel Canyon, I started getting anxious and internally panicking. If you're not familiar with Laurel Canyon, it's filled with beautiful homes, but at night, it's extremely dark and borderline freaky, especially when you consider all the history with the Manson murders in that area. Part of me feels like we're dropping ourselves off into a setup. But once we arrive, all of my worries get washed away. We pull into the driveway, and this house is beautiful and extremely.
So what does that house look like to you guys? Kind of looks like a fraternity house or a sorority house. How extravagant they are, how beautiful they are on the outside, going to the inside and have all these rooms, all these, you know, these benefits that you get, you know, like the cook and all that stuff. But speaking of that, actually Sigma Chi didn't have a cook. Excuse me. They did all their own food, but they entice you with pretty, with little trinkets and baubles and shiny things. And they're doing it right here as well.
And some murders in that area. Part of me feels like we're dropping ourselves off into a setup. But once we arrive, all of my worries get washed away. We pull into the driveway and this house is beautiful and extravagant. And everyone waiting in line to walk in is smiling and laughing and friendly. So I get excited again. At the door, they take our phones and have us sign an NDA, which isn't uncommon in house parties like this in LA. And they give us a mask and a name tag with funny aliases. My mask looked like a bear and David's looked like a bird. My alias was Stardust, which David got a crack out of. And his was Benji. We enter what you could call like the lobby of the house. And as we're walking in, the apparent host of the party starts giving a speech. This man is very eccentric and outspoken, and he's got the cadence of a late night show host. and I spot the agent that invited us standing right behind him. The speech was basically just encouraging everybody to have fun and explaining the itinerary of the night. Apparently, this was a themed room party, and all of the guests were instructed to move to the next room whenever the grandfather clock chimed. He wrapped up his speech with some cheeky joke, and then one line that still irks me to this day. He said, "Have fun now. Our descent starts at midnight." I tried to give David the eyes that I didn't like where this party was going. This type of behavior from people that I saw as adults made me extremely uncomfortable. The moment the host wrapped up his speech, a couple of workers came out of the doorway. They were holding a couple sets of long poles. All of a sudden, music started playing and everybody seemed like they knew what was going on. So I just went along with it. So I guess these parties start off with a big game of limbo. It's funny seeing people dressed so nicely playing a silly child's game, but it's even weirder seeing A-list celebrities being so excited to play because everybody had masks on. But when somebody that you grew up watching in movies walks by you with a quarter of their face covered, you still know it's them. I was amazed with how inviting and willing to introduce themselves these people were. I was expecting at least an undertone of uppityness, but it seemed like everybody was involving everybody in conversation, and they were frequently introducing themselves to me with their alias, of course. The only thing weird about it was something that I didn't notice until the third person did it. When they shook my hand, they pressed their thumb into the soft part between my thumb and my pointer finger, and I only recognized the pattern because the third guy gave me a big smile and said, "This must be your first time here." In retrospect, this should have alarmed me, but it seemed like they got friendlier when they realized that it was my first time here. So I didn't really think anything of it. But before I got to ask any follow-up questions about this odd handshake, the first grandfather clock chime went off, and everybody excitedly rushed into the second room. When I finally got in there, I was taken aback by the dramatic decor change. Everything in this room was different shades of blue. The music was romantic and all the furniture was cabana beds and love seats. I stood there for a second trying to realize what was different, but I couldn't put my finger on it until some girl walked by and caressed my shoulder in a really flirty manner. The decor changed, but the way everybody was acting was drastically different. Before, everybody seemed to be outgoing and inviting and friendly, but the second they stepped foot into this room, they became touchy, flirty, and suggestive. I was only 19 at the time, so this type of behavior from people that I saw as adults made me extremely uncomfortable. Especially when I saw that the cabana beds had curtains that you could close for privacy. And I realized that these people weren't just being suggestive, they meant it. I tried to give David the eyes that I didn't like where this party was going, but he seemed to be really enjoying the female attention, so I was on my own. I basically stayed in perpetual motion and walked laps until the next chime went off. So I didn't.
That's one of those things at, they say with the frat parties, that you have to have women there, that you need to make sure you invite women. And that needs to be a ratio that's higher usually than the men, and this kind of reminds me of that as well, kind of feels that. So anyway, I just wanted to put that out there as something that kind of stood out
for too long and let them get too comfortable. The clock finally went off and everybody rushed to the next room immediately. The weirdest part was the people that were in the private sections didn't even bother redressing except for the mask. I was in no rush to get to the next room, but I could see into it over the crowd of everybody's head. The walls were bright orange, but the smells that were wafting in from that room were amazing. And when I finally got in there, it was like the Hogwarts feast. It was table after table of the most delicious spreads I've ever seen. Tables for seafood, full table for meats, full tables of sushi and food. They were disrespectfully biting chunks out of delicious prime rib roasts. They were just shoving copious amounts of high-grade sashimi into their mouths and eating caviar like it was cereal. The way that they were just grabbing with their hands and just spitting out things that they didn't like onto the floor ruined my appetite. At this point, I wanted nothing to do with these people. So I went up to the only familiar.
That's kind of the opposite of what they do with the Black Supper with the fraternities, because they only give you like a very light meal is what they called it. When in actuality, all the things you read about is that they are deprived of food. And that, you know, is what we've heard time and time again with these hazings where these kids die, is that they didn't have any food in their stomach. They just had a lot of alcohol and other substances. And sometimes a lot of water too, which is also very bad because it can cause seizures and convulsions because of depleting your electrolytes. But this one had gluttony. So we've got gluttony going on here now too.
agent that invited me was the only other person not eating. So I approached him and lifted up my mask so he'd recognize me, considering we'd only met one time. Before I even got out my greeting or got my mask halfway off my face, he abruptly pressed my mask back into place and sharply said, "Mask stay on till the sixth room." He did it in a way that seemed like I was embarrassing him for not knowing the rules. So to ease the tension, I jokingly replied, "So we're only halfway there, huh?" He didn't laugh or make eye contact. He just dismissively replied, "I encourage you to engage in the festivities. A slow drip is better than a flood." He started to walk towards the door as the clock chimed for the next room, like he knew it was about to go off. I didn't like that interaction at all. He's the one that invited me here, and he seemed to have no interest in talking to me. I just kept going over what he said the entire time while we were in the next room. This room was yellow and basically just a casino. I wanted to talk to David privately and let him know that I wanted to leave, but he seemed to just be caught up in the momentum of the party. Plus, there was a roulette table in the room, and David's freakishly good at roulette. So at this point, the winning streak that he's building is the center point of the party. I can't fully focus on what the agent said to me because I have to pretend to be excited about David's winning streak in a fake casino where you're not actually winning money. And like clockwork, the chime goes off. The entire party starts rushing to the next room again, and the vibe changes dramatically. I'm the last person to walk into the bright red room. This room didn't seem to have a specific activity like the others. It was just empty and bright red, and everybody was whispering to each other. For a split second, I thought it might be a big game of telephone or something silly like that. But as I started walking through and brushing shoulders with these people and hearing what they were saying to each other, I started questioning everything. The same people that I saw laughing and celebrating and eating together were whispering the most heinous, offensive comments directly to each other. I mean, things that you wouldn't even say behind your friend's back. They were saying it to their face. I'm talking friendship-ending secrets and personal opinions about each other laced with envy and jealousy. I hurry to a quiet corner.
This makes me think of the girls down at the grub truck and wherever else that they were doing this. But these things that they're saying to each other, like blatantly, to where they could be heard, and wanting Maddie and Kaylee to hear them, pointing, laughing, mocking, things like that. So the room of red is not a nice room.
People that I saw laughing and celebrating and eating together were whispering the most heinous, offensive comments directly to each other. I mean, things that you wouldn't even say behind your friend's back. They were saying it to their face. I'm talking friendship-ending secrets and personal opinions about each other laced with envy and jealousy. I hurry to a quiet corner because I was sick of hearing everybody's dirty laundry after walking around for a minute and a half. And it all clicked. I knew exactly what this party was. I see the host ask the first person in line a question before having them repeat something that he said, "When I tell you I am done with this party, I'm absolutely not doing that." All the dots start connecting in my head while everybody's being horrible to each other around me. I'm trying to recap the whole night and remember the order of
what did he say? Something about he started to connect all the dots in his head. All the dots. How many dots? As in people were there in the stories and stuff. Now, I don't know much about Dot. I don't know. I didn't talk. I listened to a few things. All of it seems so weird. But I guess there was the one Dot, and then there was the Braden. And I don't know. I think I saw Dot at the grub truck, to tell you the truth. And I thought I saw what to me, what Dot sounded.
I just want people to know that when you're doing other people's vids, she might be doing a stretch here, but you can only go so long on people's vids, especially if you don't know them. They can do a copyright strike on you. So she has to stop it ever so long. And she probably runs out of things to say. So I'm just... just letting you know.
Sounded like to me in the videos that I've heard, this is what I'm saying when I say I think I saw her at the grub truck or walking in front of 1122 King Road the morning of. It's because the sound of the voice and that person connects something in my head. So like I'm going to go back and say this again. is that I swear I could see Dot at the grub truck and also walking with another guy. Oh my gosh, that's a video I forgot to put out. I forgot about that one. Oh my goodness.
He's being horrible to each other around me. I'm trying to recap the whole night and remember the order of each room to solidify my suspicions. But the chime for the next room goes off. This time, everybody gets eerily quiet and calm, like they got all of their venom out. The host of the party announces for all of the newcomers to come to the front. All of the attendees form a single file line in front of the next room's door. There's about 10 other newcomers in front of me and David, and the agent that invited us is standing to the left of the door, and the host of the party is standing to the right. The host has a pile of books on the table next to him. I see the host ask the first person in line a question and then grab a book based on his answer. He would present the book to the person and place a diamond-shaped metal symbol on top of it before having them repeat something that he said. Then he'd take their mask off and let them enter the next room. I couldn't make out exactly what he was doing until there was only two people ahead of me in line. The books were Bibles, Qurans, Torahs, and so on. He would ask the person, "And which one is yours?" Whichever they chose, he'd grab it and place the metal symbol on top of it. He'd have you put your hand on top of the metal symbol and then repeat, "I am my own God. I bow to nobody but myself. When I tell you I am done with this party," and I whip my head around and I tell David I'm absolutely not doing that. David whispered back in a joking tone like he always does, "Dude, it's just a party. Who cares? I'll see you in the next room." And he's...
So, there's that, where they, you know, with the person's beliefs and their God, and their God, you know, whoever they believe in, and worship, whatever, however you want to say it, they take that away from you with this Greek society, because they break you down to build you up into what they want you to be. And now your God is the Greek society, and you do as they say, and you pay. And you pay for it. You know, you not only pay for it in what they've got over your head, but you pay for it in monetary wise, like every month. I don't know if it's every month dues, every year, I'm not sure, but they pay a pretty penny. You know, I kind of got to thinking about that the other day. I'm thinking about why the continual dues being paid. I'm like, well, maybe it's for lawyers. Maybe they have a fund for lawyers, a kitty, you know? Maybe that's where that money goes. Or it could go to many different things. Many, many different things. I mean, let's say payment for a hitman. I mean, I don't know. Could go to many different things. Pure speculation, just my opinion. Just talking out my butt. Okay, here we go.
With this party. And I whip my head around and I tell David I'm absolutely not doing that. David whispered back in a joking tone like he always does, "Dude, it's just a party. Who cares? I'll see you in the next room." And he skipped me in line to show me that he'd do it first to make me feel more comfortable. He went through with it and giggled his way into the next room. It was my turn, so I tried to play it cool and whisper to the host, "Do you mind if I skip this part? It's making me a little bit uncomfortable." I thought he'd subtly break character and reassure me that this is just a party theme and it's all good. Instead, he whispered back to me in a really kind tone, "Of course, man, don't worry about it. Just take your mask off and turn around." I was relieved for about a split second before the agent that invited me here grabbed my arm and started guiding me towards the exit. And I see that everybody that was behind me in line staring at me straight faced. I look back at the host and he's standing up and loudly shouts like he's starting a chant. The price was not paid. And then everybody in line that was staring at me chants in unison like they knew exactly what to do. Remove the profane. And they repeat it over and over until I'm through the exit door. The price was not paid. Remove the profane. The price was not paid. Remove the profane. So the agent just walks me to the closest door. He doesn't even walk me to the front of the party and out the front door. He just puts me out into the backyard. It's 4 a.m. My friend's still inside. I don't have my phone. So I decide.
Did you guys hear that? It's 4 a.m. It's 4 a.m. This is also in the ritual book for Sigma Chi that they don't start until dark. Basically, after midnight is what I think, is what I remember reading and putting down in the video. But they also mention those wee hours between like 3, 4 a.m. in the ritual book. It is their hour. I find that very strange with this.
Door. He doesn't even walk me to the front of the party and out the front door. He just puts me out into the backyard. It's 4 a.m. My friend's still inside. I don't have my phone. So I decide to walk around the right side of the house because that's where all of the party attendees were kind of headed. Let me see if I could peek in and maybe flag down David to let him know I got kicked out. And there's some windows to the next room. But of course, these windows are like big church stained glass windows. And you can't really see through stained glass windows, like the colored ones. But if you go really, really close and you look through the white parts, you could kind of see clearly what is on the inside. And this room is like a bizarre church replica without all of the seating. It's just a big church-like room. And all of the people that were in there had their masks off. And it was like a big...
And it was a church-like setting. The big windows. And everybody that was in there, they had their masks off. Because now they're at a point of no return. So it doesn't matter if their masks are off or on. So we might as well take them off. And they're all in a big circle, like a ritual. Isn't that what he said? Initiation.
You could kind of see clearly what is on the inside. And this room is like a bizarre church replica without all of the seating. It's just a big church-like room. And all of the people that were in there had their masks off. And it was like a big circle and almost looked like an initiation. And all of these celebrities are standing around in a circle around the other 9 new people. It was 10 excluding me. And there was big TV grade cameras recording, and it looked like the group of celebrities and everybody else that was there was kind of cheering them on. But then there was clearly people in there that were much more serious and kind of threatening, and the 10 new people were in the middle of this room being forced to do horrible things, things that I wish I could unsee. And the new people clearly didn't want to do these things. They were being forced to do these things.
Did you guys just hear that? Does any of this sound familiar to you guys? They are being forced to do heinous things. And they were clearly recording it. Certainly sounds like something we've heard before. This is scary. Sorry for the Wi-Fi disconnecting, keep popping in and out of my video. Sorry about that. I'm actually outside, so it's a proper connection, I guess. I've been doing it a lot lately, so I'm not sure what that's all about. But anyway, my apologies. Okay, here we go.
Room being forced to do horrible things, things that I wish I could unsee. And the new people clearly didn't want to do these things. They were being forced to do these things. And they're clearly recording it. And I see my friend being forced to do.
Now, again, my crime family, there's famous people at this party, Hollywood people type people at this party. Of course, he's not going to name them. But this is a well-to-do party. And this is, I'm telling you, man, this is some freaky shit. And see how it compares to the Idaho 4 stuff.
Do these horrible things in front of these people and in front of these cameras. I just start panicking. I don't know what to do it. So in my head, I'm like, I just need to get out of here. So I start speed walking to the front of the house, and I'm thinking, I need to get out of this gate. There's only one street. We're on Laurel Canyon. So it's either I go left and start running towards Studio City, or I go right and start running towards West Hollywood. I'm not about to go knock on other people's doors. I'm just trying to get back to like civilization. And I'm trying to remember if we're closer to Studio City or if we're closer to West Hollywood. I don't even know. As I get to the front of the house, one of the employees is standing there, and he's standing in front of a car, and he has my phone. I'm not sure if he knows that I just saw everything. So I'm kind of standing there deer in headlights, but he just politely goes, here's your phone and here's your ride. Don't worry, the driver will take you home. So I take my phone and I sit in the car, and I'm trying to gauge to see if this driver has any malicious intent, but he doesn't seem to. And within the first 3 minutes,
So they got them a driver to take him home. As far as he could see, the driver didn't have any malicious intent. Does that sound familiar?
And here's your ride. Don't worry, the driver will take you home. So I take my phone and I sit in the car and I'm trying to gauge to see if this driver has any malicious intent, but he doesn't seem to. And within the first 3 minutes, I know that they don't think I saw anything. They were just getting my stuff prepared and my car prepared to take me home. Cause they're under the impression that I didn't see anything too bad. And I got kicked out before any horrible things started happening to people inside of this party. So I get in the car and I'm checking my phone. My phone is fully charged when I got here. So I don't know what they did, but my phone won't turn on. I have to sit through this 30-minute car ride. One of my best friends is back at this party getting mistreated and recorded doing horrible.
So there's another thing. The phone. They went through the phone. So where's Kaylee's phone? Why haven't the G's been told about Kaylee's phone or other things that they took? There's not even a list, is what G said. Is that? That can't be legal. I mean, that just really can't be legal. They have to have a record of these things. Just like when someone's arrested, they record whatever they take out of their pockets, whether it's 2 pennies or 50 pennies. It's taken out of their pocket and it's recorded and it's put in safety into a safety box or into a card, whatever, however they put it in, into the evidence room where that should be under lock and key. And should not be tampered with until they are released, if they are ever released. But, or it could be released to somebody else. I don't know how, what happens in that situation, but it's supposed to be documented so that they know exactly what was in there. And it's supposed to stay like that. Not supposed to be taking anything out of it or added to it.
I don't know what they did, but my phone won't turn on. I have to sit through this 30-minute car ride. One of my best friends is back at this party getting mistreated and recorded doing horrible things, and I can't tell anybody. So I get through this 30-minute horrible, suspense-filled car ride, thinking about all of the people that were so nice to me inside of this party, and the whole intent of this party was to butter me up to get me to do these horrible things. And when I...
So there's so much in this. You guys, I'm sorry I keep stopping it, but I have to. Otherwise, I will not remember. So all these people that were so nice prior, so nice. What does that remind you of? Oh, my queen, my God, my princess. Oh, you're so beautiful. Oh, you know, blah, 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 blah. What all the sorority conversations look like in these comments. And the men too. The men are just as bad, but in a different way. They're all nicey-nicey, pretending. Come on, nobody likes somebody that much to where they're constantly just, I mean, they might as well just be, you know, cleaning their shoes with their tongue every time they do that, because that's exactly how grotesque it is, the way they act. This is following suit. What he's talking about is what they do in this Greek system. And that's scary, because this is a scary story. Very scary story. And this story is going to follow through with everything that's happening in Moscow. Believe you me, I will show you the police reports. I will show them to you.
Suspense-filled car ride, thinking about all of the people that were so nice to me inside of this party, and the whole intent of this party was to butter me up to get me to do these horrible things. And when I finally get back to my apartment, I run upstairs, I plug my phone into the charger, and the first texts that come through are from my friend Joe. And I completely forgot that my friend Joe was coming to visit me. He was coming on a little mini vacation, and I was going to play tour guide and show him around the city. So now I'm thinking, I only have like 4.5 hours to sleep before I have to go pick up my friend from the airport, and I still don't know if my other friend is okay. So I'm blowing up David's phone because he's still at this party, but I set a timer so I get to the airport to pick up my other friend. So I barely get any sleep. I drive to LAX to go pick up Joe, and I drive him back to my apartment. And when I'm coming back into my apartment, David's in the lobby and he's talking to some other big creators, like bouncing video ideas. It's like 9:30, 10 a.m. at this point. So we're just kind of having coffee by the cafe and chatting. I tell Joe to go upstairs to my apartment and drop off his luggage. And I go ask David if I could talk to him really quick. I'm clearly very distressed and he's being very jokey with me. And he doesn't seem like anything bad happened. And he's just kind of making fun of me for getting kicked out of the party. I'm just letting him talk for a little bit, and I finally tell him I was looking in through the next window. I saw what they made him do, and I was just asking him if he's okay. And the second I said that, he immediately switched on me, and he started damn near cussing me out and saying friendship-ending things, and his eyes turned from happy and giddy to filled with almost fear and a little bit of betrayal. When he stormed off, he pulled out his phone, and he was calling somebody as if he was, like, reporting something back to them. I immediately start freaking out. I assume that he's telling them that I saw what they did, and now I have my friend upstairs who thinks he's just on vacation. When I just saw hyper-successful, rich people doing unspeakable acts, and they have all of the resources to come after me. They know what.
So there you have the guy getting on his phone to call whoever he needs to call to make whatever this guy just said go away. Maddie, what did you tell Adam? Well, I told Adam everything. So then who did Adam tell? And then the person that Adam told, did they tell somebody else? There's a ball rolling here. And it's picking up speed. And this guy right here is telling the same fucking story.
I just saw hyper-successful, rich people doing unspeakable acts, and they have all of the resources to come after me. They know where I live, and David isn't even on my side because the dirt that they have on him now. I have to pretend that everything's okay to Joe because he flew all the way out here for a vacation, and I don't even really know how bad the situation is. I don't even know how to tell him about everything that happened the night before, and I promised Joe that we're going to go to Runyon Canyon this morning. So he goes and changes into hiking gear, and I drive him over to Runyon Canyon. We do the hike for a few hours, and when we come back and I check my mail, there's another letter from these people, and I take it to the bathroom because I don't even want Joe to see it. And it's a screenshot of the surveillance footage of me looking in through the window and a little handwritten note, just a reminder of the worst mistake you've ever made. Curiosity killed the cat. And I start freaking out. I know that David.
So that's where the surveillance comes in. That's where the tripod outside of that house was not something that the photography group just put there. There's a reason why that footage is not found. And there's a reason why the person, the guy that talked about that footage said that they didn't have to share what they had. Like they didn't have to do that. They said they did, but it's not been even brought up. Nobody knows about that footage. Or what happened to that stuff on that tribe from that photography group, or why it was there from 8 a.m., you know, for 24 hours, from what they said was 24 hours. That's because that footage is just what this guy said here, what his friend did. That his friend now is their bitch. Because he was recorded with what he did. And now they're going to hold that against him. They've got it all holding against him. They're going to give him the world. Oh, sure. They're going to build him up. You know, they broke him down by doing what they did. They broke him down to build him back up. So they broke him down by making him do these, whatever they made him do. And photographed and videoed the whole thing. And now they're going to build him back up to be what they want him to be. He is now theirs. He's no longer his own person. He's theirs. And he has to report back to these people, just like he rang on the phone, reporting what was happening. He's got a tell on him. He is now the snitch, right? But apparently, it's a different kind of snitch. Because what if he didn't snitch? Would he be taken out if he didn't snitch? It's all kind of convoluted. It's so weird. But what he said, his friend, this guy said here, is that now they have it over his head, what he had done, what they had him do, you know, what they photographed him doing. So now the guy really basically has no way out unless he just wants to run wild and escape from this creepiness or whatever. And in my opinion, that's kind of what's going on in Moscow. So those are the people right there that are maybe unaliving themselves. Maybe they can't handle it. Maybe they're being stalked. They're being threatened. I mean, it's all in the police reports. It's every day. Fraud. Their cars are being hit, spray painted, mirrors broken, tires slashed. Their animals are being killed. Can't get anything past these guys, huh? Because they pull out all the stop, man. They don't even think twice about it. They just do what they're told. And all those little minions in that university are doing the dirty for these higher-ups.
Surveillance footage of me looking in through the window and a little handwritten note, just a reminder of the worst mistake you've ever made. Curiosity killed the cat. And I start freaking out. I know that David just betrayed me and told them that I saw, and now they have proof that I saw. Now I'm just a walking liability to them, and now they're threatening me, and that was the worst mistake that I've ever made, and insinuating that curiosity killed the cat. I'm the cat, but it's still not enough to tell Joe about what happened. So I just go on with this charade, and I'm just playing tourist, bringing my friend around the city. And the first day, nothing happened. And to this day, I firmly believe that the only reason they didn't do anything to me is because Joe was there with me that whole week, and he had just finished the police academy, and he was officially a police officer. So I think me being with him is the only thing that kept me safe, because they weren't willing to do anything to a police officer. And I knew for sure they were keeping an eye on me the next day, because Joe asked me the night before if I had half and half for our coffees the next morning, and I didn't have any half and half, and he just jokingly said, "Who has coffee and doesn't have half and half?" It was a conversation in passing. It was a joke. And the next morning we woke up and there was a full half and half in my fridge. And the only reason I noticed that is because Joe said, "Thanks for running out early and grabbing half and half. You didn't have to do that. I was kidding." I didn't go and grab that half and half. I knew that somebody was not only listening, but entered my apartment that night while we were asleep. And then they started to do these things that only I would notice. Things that if you told anybody, they would look at you like you were crazy. Each night that we came home and we were just winding down and watching TV, I would go to turn my TV on and the remote control wouldn't work. And I would check the batteries, and the batteries would be switched from positive to negative and negative to positive. Like they came into my house and just flipped my batteries. I know that my remote control worked the day before, and they just needed me to know that they were in my house and flipped my batteries, just to let me know that they were invading my privacy on a daily basis. And
so you guys, that is happening in the police reports, has been happening, has always happened, so on and so forth. There's people reporting that people are coming into her house and moving her things around, but nothing's taken. There's reports of people with lights on, coming home and their lights are on. Or, I mean, all sorts of reports, all kinds of different things like that. And it's actually escalating right now. There's a lot in the police reports about that right now. But the same thing, just letting, or knocking, coming up and just knocking on the door and then like moving away from, so you can't see, you know, what's going on. A lot of that. There's a lot of, with the dogs barking. How about with the dogs constantly barking? That, in my opinion, is somebody creeping around the house. You get dogs, a lot of people get dogs for protection, right? So what are they going to do? They expect them to bark when something's going on. So, and they do bark. And what if they bark for hours and they never stop? Is that person just hanging out there? Because the dog can smell them and they're going to bark? Kind of creepy, right?
and flipped my batteries, just to let me know that they were invading my privacy on a daily basis. And then it started escalating to when I would take Joe to lunch, or we would pop to the grocery store, or we would go to the movies, and we would come back to the car, and my left blinker would be on. They would just open my car and put it down, and every time we would come back to the car, my left turning signal would be on. It happened like 6 times. How can I tell anybody that somebody broke into my car and turned my left signal down? It's something that only I would notice, and I can't tell Joe because I'm not trying to scare him, and it's also something that I don't even think he would take seriously. He would probably say, you probably hit it down when you were stepping out of the car. And then things started to pick up. They started to do very specific things to me that weren't just by chance. We came home one day and I locked the door behind me like I was doing every time because I was super, super paranoid. My apartment door lock just locked swiftly. My apartment door lock doesn't lock swiftly. I would have to like press into it and jiggle it and force it to lock. And it's been like that since I moved in. And it had this sharp little nub on the front that I would feel with my thumb every single day. And one of the days we came home, and it just smoothly locked and the nub wasn't there. So they were letting me know that I can't even lock them out. But how do I tell anybody that they're doing this to me? Because they would just say the apartment was probably aware of it and changed it. And I still wasn't able to tell Joe because I would think that he would come to the same conclusion. But then the next day, we go to the car to go to breakfast and we get into my old car that I've had for 5 or 6 years at the time. And I grab my gear shifter and I go to pull it into reverse and it smoothly goes from park to reverse. And my gear shifter doesn't smoothly go from park to reverse. You have to wiggle it in a certain way. You have to press the button with your thumb in a certain way to get it into reverse. I only know this because I drove this car every single day for 5 years, and this gear shifter is pretty much broken. It's an old car. And that morning I got into my car and it smoothly went from park to reverse, and the wooden finish on the gear shifter was different. Mine had scratches on it and this one was brand new. So they were telling me not only are they able to just break into my car and turn the left signal down, they're also willing to manipulate my car. Now I know.
Okay, so think about this for a minute. Think about all these things, like what's happening to this guy, right? Now think about you being that person that saw something that you can't say anything about, that you know you can't say anything about because they're going to get you if you do. And think about you not even thinking about talking about it because you know they're going to get you. But then this kind of stuff starts happening to you. And you start thinking, oh my God, do they think I said something or something like that? I mean, are they going to come get me? What are they going to do? Are they watching? Well, obviously they're watching me because these things are happening. Yet in your mind, you're thinking, am I just making this stuff up in my head? This is gaslighting. This is called gaslighting. And this is to the extreme of gaslighting, to where they're actually coming in and manipulating your things. And like he said, only you would know that, like only he would know that, right? So I know this because of my mother. Now, my mother used to trigger me by certain things that she would say or a look she would give me or anything. And no one else around me would even think it was anything. Like they wouldn't even bat an eye because it wasn't toward, she did it because she knew it would do something to me. She was well aware of what it would do. So when I responded and I reacted to it in the way that I did, it made me look like I was a little bit nuts or a little bit off my rockers or way too sensitive or whatever it may be at the time. But she'd already laid the path for that prior to her doing that to me. She would talk to whoever it was, like that she would know was going to be coming over or whatnot. And she would be like, oh, well, she's feeling a little off today, or she's been feeling really off lately, and this, you know, real sensitive, or whatever it was. So she already laid the path for what my reaction was going to be, knowing full well what my reaction was going to be, because she knew how to trigger me. So now think about that, and think about what this guy's going through, and knowing that these people are able to just break into a place. And with you telling somebody, like even telling the cops something like that, they'd be like, oh, are you sure? You know, you sure that happened? Or, you know, what's so bad about that? I mean, that's kind of nice that someone would do that. Whatever it is. No, it's not nice. Someone's invading your privacy. Someone's trying to drive you goddamn crazy or make you look crazy. More than that, they're trying to make you look crazy. And then when you talk to other people and these other people are starting to look at you like maybe you're a little crazy as well, yet you know you're not crazy because it's happening to you, and you know exactly what's happening to you. You know your shifter didn't do that. You know this is the way your door locked. You know you didn't have half and half. It's all the above. Yet it somehow makes people question who you are and what is your mental stability, what's going on in your head. And this is where, in my opinion, these people that go off and they start feeling unstable and they start talking about taking their own lives, this is how this is starting. This is how this is a whole scenario right here. This is what's happening. This is what the fuck's happening, man. They're taking these people to the edge of a building and egging them to jump off the ledge. I don't know what's worse, them actually just going up and just taking them and, you know, getting rid of them, or bringing them to the point that they would do it to themselves. I mean, some people it probably takes a lot more time to do that than others, but still, to bring someone to that point, that either they're thinking they're crazy, or they're at the point where nobody believes them, and they don't feel safe, they don't feel like they can talk to anybody at this point about anything. Because now these people that you couldn't talk about what happened already, and you knew that and you didn't talk about it, they now have brought you to the brink that you can't talk about anything for fear of what it might make you look like, or already has with your loved ones, your significant others, you know, anything like that, your friends, anything, your doctors. I mean, from what it looks like, the doctors are all in and around there as well. So you can't even really, there's nobody you can talk to. Who do you talk to? Who do you go to? You can't go to the cops. Many, many, many years ago, I came to the conclusion that the people that people call insane are actually the sane people, because those people know what's going on. And this sounds just like this.
Turn the left signal down, they're also willing to manipulate my car. Now I know for sure Joe isn't safe either, and me not telling him these things puts him into danger because I'm driving him around in this car. And if they could change my gear shifter, why wouldn't they be able to cut my brakes? So I basically just break down and I have to tell Joe everything from start to finish about... So I basically just break down and I have to tell Joe everything from start to finish about this weird party with this weird agent and the little things that I've been noticing all week, and that this was the last straw. And Joe believed me because we used to drive around in my car together all of the time, and sometimes he would drive my car, and he made me promise that I did not get that fixed. The gear shifter was still broken yesterday and it's fixed today, and I didn't do that. So that won him over, and he basically said, we need to get out of here. It shook him too. He didn't like the idea of these people in the house. When I told him I didn't get the half and half, when I told him all of these things that were adding up over the last couple days, it freaked him out. He's like, bro, we got to go back to your apartment. We got to get your stuff. We got to get you out of here. Then my entire world is shattering. I moved out here and all of these things were going great for me, and I had a place and I had friends, and I didn't want to leave. Maybe the stuff will die out. I'll be able to work with other people. It's going to be okay. I don't want to just leave my apartment, leave all my stuff. But Joe insisted that we went back to my apartment to grab his stuff and mine and then go stay at a motel before he leaves the next day. And when we got to my apartment, David was in the lobby with other creators by the cafe again, and I went up to him, I didn't really have any idea about what I was going to say to him. All he did was hand me a coffee, ignore everything that I said, and walk away. But then when I looked at the coffee, it had a little napkin wrapped around it. I saw that something was written in Sharpie on the napkin. It said, "I'm so sorry. You have to leave tomorrow with him. Otherwise, it's me and you." And I went upstairs and I packed a couple backpacks and I left LA the next morning with my friend and I never went back. Joe and I rushed out of that.
So with that napkin and what was written on it, that means that they probably stuck some type of surveillance on their vehicle because they heard what they were talking about. So you've got that. Now you've got them listening in. You've got, you're constantly under surveillance, whether video, audio, whatever it may be. Kind of like how I feel that happened that night with Maddie. I feel like maybe there was an air tracker or whatever they're called put into her coat or whatever. They were tracked. I feel like they were being tracked, or maybe through drone, whatever. But what this guy's saying is that that guy, they knew, and they also told his friend. Thank God his friend actually grew a little bit of balls to write that on the napkin to warn him.
Upstairs and I packed a couple backpacks and I left LA the next morning with my friend and I never went back. Joe and I rushed out of that city as fast as we could. I packed as much of my stuff as I could and we just started driving. We were both genuinely scared for our safety at that point. So we decided to skip Joe's scheduled flight and just drive to Las Vegas. And then we were just going to fly home from there. There was something that just felt comforting about being out of the state. Not to mention Joe wanted a real briefing about what went down, because I had just basically told him the cliff notes and begged him to believe me so that we could pick up and leave as soon as possible. For the first 2 hours of the drive, we primarily kept our heads on a swivel and just made sure that we didn't take any wrong turns to further extend this trip. There were a few cars that made me feel like we were being followed, but it was just my paranoia enhancing an A-type personality driver into a stalker. Once we were out of California state lines and into Nevada, we could both finally exhale. I felt real relief wash over me for the first time since I got kicked out of that party. We stopped about 15 minutes into Nevada at a pit stop. We used their Wi-Fi to book a hotel for Vegas that night, along with the plane tickets for the next morning. Once we had our escape plan fully booked, Joe just started laughing and I couldn't help but just start laughing too. We shared a lot of crazy stories growing up and we always seemed to find ourselves in sticky situations together. So it was just hilarious that his fun trip to visit me turned into this. It felt really good to laugh about it because it made me feel like it was finally over. We got back into the car to continue our drive and Joe playfully said, "So you have 1 hour to explain to me why we're fleeing Los Angeles over some half and half and a gear shifter before we get to Vegas and we make this trip worth it." I realized how bizarre this whole situation must have looked from his perspective. He flew in for a fun vacation and arrived to see his friend in a crisis. As I started to explain to him the series of events, things really started to click for me, especially with his input as a police officer. I'm going to recap some of the events that I had already explained, but with the conclusions that we came to together. Clearly, the man that invited us to the party was a predator, and we were just perfect targets for him. We were young kids with enough of a following on socials to influence all of the other young creators in the area. We had just made a major change in our life by moving across the country, and we were completely isolated from our families who we could consult with about important decision making. And we were in a bad financial situation because at the time, just having a following on the internet didn't equal revenue. We were perfect targets to be indoctrined into a system where they could have full control over our budding careers. And apparently, that's exactly what cult-like communities look for potential members. Not to mention, we were in LA trying to make a career in entertainment, and it seemed like they held the key to our dreams. As I was explaining to Joe the invitation and how it showed up to my house, we came to the conclusion that this guy approaching us at that party was not a coincidence. He had to have been scouting us prior to the time that I thought that we just met by chance. The party itself was a trap as well. When I finally had the chance to process what he said to me about the slow drip is better than a flood, it really started to make sense. Each room was designed to slowly introduce you into giving into temptation and sin. Everybody there being so nice and inviting was clearly on purpose. Seeing all of these people that you've looked up to for years indulging in these temptations of each room and inviting you to join in with them is perfect peer pressure. You don't want to let your idols down, so you voluntarily engage in an activity in each room that just gets progressively worse and worse. And of course, Of course, they start with flirtiness and overeating delicious food. And of course, spirits, because those things are so easy to give into. But the temptations of the night keep getting worse as you go on. He wanted me to feel the slow drip, so when it was time to commit the heinous acts of the sixth room, it didn't feel like a flood. It's clear why they kicked me out when they did. I wasn't indulging the way everybody else had. And when it came to the time to defame my religion, it was the last straw. Most people, like myself, would think it was just part of the party theme. But to them, it's the test to see if you're broken down enough to defame your religion for the fun of the party. That's why the sixth room was the flood. It was dramatically worse than the rooms that I had experienced. And the only way somebody would give in to the peer pressure to do what they were doing in that room is them being primed to do so with everything that happened before and had just spoken the words that they're not God-fearing. I realized that the people that would go to that party didn't just blow up overnight because of the power of that little cultish group. They scouted young creators like myself and David, who they believed were going to blow up regardless of their help, and get them to commit heinous acts on camera. So when they did eventually blow up, they had the perfect blackmail on them to control them. They would try to get to you early, so before you were making money independently, so that they could control you. Because if you were already established and wealthy, why would you even care about going to a party like this? You just don't care. It's too late for them to infiltrate your life. Do they help you with big collaborations? Yeah, but these collaborations are built off of fear and trauma. That's how they keep their group so tight. You can't get into this group unless you also do these horrible things. They kicked me out and let me leave because they thought I actually didn't see anything too bad. From the outside perspective, I had just gone to a cool A-list party in a beautiful home filled with beautiful people and amazing food. I couldn't say anything bad about it publicly without sounding bitter that I got kicked out. That's how groups like this need to operate. From the outside looking in, it has to look amazing and wonderful to be a part of. From the inside, they need blackmail that's so bad on you that you can never speak out against it without getting your reputation destroyed. It made sense why they went after me the way they did. They need to do things to me that only I would notice because they couldn't be seen openly harassing. It would make them look bad. So they had to infiltrate my privacy and scare me secretly. I still don't know how far they would have gone to get me to leave the city, if they would get violent or try to get me to fall victim to an accident. But they wanted to scare me out of the city. And I thought back to my very kind friend that warned me about this part and how secretive he was being about how much he knew about it. He couldn't just openly say how weird those people were because it would make him a target. He just knew that if he kindly declined their offers and acted like he knew nothing about them, he could go about pursuing his career unbothered. And it really made sense why they would target potential big creators as well. Because if the kid with the most clout is a part of this group, and the only way to collaborate with him was to go through the same indoctrination, they would be able to control an entire generation of creators. To be honest, they're very good at what they do. There was a clear system that they followed, and the way that they approached harassing me out of the city, it was done at a professional level. Joe told me that it's called gang stalking, and that most of the time, it actually isn't happening. And what I mean by that is most of the time that somebody reports that a crime like this is being committed, it's actually a paranoid schizophrenic having an episode. So they harass you in a way that even the police department would consider it a mental disorder, opposed to gang stalking. Everything about the way these people operate.
Booyah. He just said what I said. Oh, it's a nutshell, man. Like, wow. That gang stalking. Yeah. The Greek system is a gang. They're a gang. So who was stalking Kaylee? All of them, in my opinion, all of them were. For Christ's sakes, this is just unbelievable. How do people get away with this kind of stuff? I'll tell you why. Because there's those higher ups that allow it to happen and have allowed it to happen year after year after year. And the more it happens like that and they get away with it, the more powerful it becomes. Especially when nobody addresses it. They don't talk about it. They don't bring it up. They sweep it under a rug. They let people die. They turn their heads the other way and they just let it happen, knowing it's going to happen because they know damn well the months that hazings are more prevalent. And for them, for this to happen the way it happened with these four students, not student to me anymore. Kaylee, Maddie, they allowed this to just evaporate because they let everybody go. They should have locked that damn town down. They should have locked the town down, period. With half of the people in that town being students, what makes them think it wouldn't be a student?
Consider it a mental disorder opposed to gang stalking. Everything about the way these people operate is cult-like, and everything that they do is intentional. I was never even a conspiracy theorist or anything like that, but my perspective on show business and Hollywood completely changed on the way to Vegas. All the dots connected, and I saw how truly evil some people in that industry actually are. And when I got to Vegas, I started to see how openly they show it. I know I've spent this whole time talking about how secret and exclusive this party was, and how everybody that knows about it has their lips zipped shut, but when we had arrived at our hotel near the strip, I started looking around at the big signs and promotions, and they really don't hide it. There was cultish symbolism in all of the music, live performances, and movie trailers. What used to look like just cool designs and eccentric artists was blatant symbolism for what was actually going on. I will never look at showbiz the same after that. I'm extremely happy being an independent artist, safe in the middle of the country, away from those cultish hedonists. I never received another letter or heard from David again, but what I can tell you is that everybody that was affiliated with that group became massively famous, but everybody involved fell as hard as they ascended and have had even more massive controversies. And to anybody pursuing a life in the arts or social media, do not fall into this trap. They will promise you everything that you've ever wanted, but they'll take it away whenever they please. And I promise you will hurt the people around you in the process. Welcome to the society. Guys.
There you have it right there. They grew fast, right straight to the top, and then they fell just as hard. Never to probably recover, because they don't want you to recover. See, because they own you. Symbolism everywhere, all over the Greek society, symbol after symbol after symbol. I mean, and they blatantly display it. The white cross, Constantine. I mean, Stacey Chapin was pinned the first woman Constantine for the Sigma Chi, right? In that chapter or whatever there, or all of all time, I don't even know. Just know that she was pinned Constantine. Now that is spooky. I can't remember what he said in the very end of this, but it's so true. I'm gonna go back a little bit and let it play, because it made so much sense of what's exactly going down. I mean, it's, they do what they want. They own you, basically. You have no say over it. You're already at your crossroads. You've already sold your soul to the devil by doing their bidding from the very beginning, because you wanted to be in a brotherhood or a sisterhood. Because you maybe got a little greedy and wanted a little bit more out of life without having to work for it. Well, guess what? You're going to be working for it. You'll always be working for it, and you'll always be looking over your back, over your shoulder, because someone's sneaking up on you. They're going to be watching you, because you've got secrets. You've got secrets you're not supposed to talk about. You don't think they're not going to be constantly watching you? Are you kids out there nuts? Think about it. Really fucking think about it. I'm talking to you kids in the universities that want to get into those sororities and those fraternities. They're going to own your asses. And they're going to slap them whenever they damn well please. And they're also going to take them out whenever they damn well please. They might even bury your ass up. Face down, ass up. It's a nasty Two Live Crew song. Nasty song. Don't ever want to be buried face down, ass up. Don't you want to live your life on your own terms and not on someone else's? Because if you do, don't friend Molly, that's for sure. Don't friend Jake. Definitely don't rush. Just don't do it.
They will promise you everything that you've ever wanted, but they'll take it away whenever they please. And I promise you will hurt the people around you in the process. Welcome to the society. Guys, if you enjoyed this story and you want to watch more, I have plenty of full stories and episodes on the channel. We have the Stairs, the Giggler, and we got a couple more coming. So if you haven't subscribed already, I would deeply appreciate it if you did. Of course, like this video. I'm an independent artist, so your likes and subscribes and comments mean well.
There you go, you guys. Get over there. Like, subscribe, comment. Share his content.
All right, what do you think of that story? I'm kind of a lot of like comparisons to the Idaho 4 and some of that stuff that people are seeing and more in that area and seeing in those reflections on Bubbly's True Killer Crimes video and Bubbly's video, who brought it out more than anybody else has. And another one, a good one to go watch is We Know What You Did. Good channels. They're the ones that, you know, they back me up in what I did, and they're doing a better job of it. And I really appreciate them a lot for it. Yeah. But yeah, it's been a good night, a couple hours in, and mods, we have a, you know, afterwards we'll be in Discord or whatever, and I'll talk over a couple of things there. Rolling Motos, the other one. Yep, you got that right, Angela. Yep, there's five of us. There's five of us that have dug into this, and I would love to have them all on panel. To tell you the truth, I'd love to have them all on panel because we could really bring to light how to do this because we, you know what I mean? Because we all have done it kind of in different ways and what are the best ways. And I think it would be just awesome to have them all on panel at the same time. We will be working on that. We will be working on that. Okay, so, and who doesn't, but yeah, who does she, yeah, she's gotten to that a little bit. She was more grub truck, but yeah. Actually, you know what? She hasn't been coming up on my stream for some reason. I'm going to have to go look for her. And then happy birthday to Joey a few days ahead of time here or something, it looks like. But anyway, yeah, it was a good night. And I hope you all had an awesome Easter. And my beautiful, beautiful subscribers, you are my heart. And my beautiful mods, you are my soul. Until next time, rock and roll!
Now let me ride. open around your door. In the still of the night, I feel my heart beating heavy. Tell me I gotta have more. In the shadow of night, I see the four more eyes. Tell me what's in store. My heart is start aching, my body starts shaking, and I can't take no more.
Still of the night.